Welcome to the mangroves, your first salty habitat.
These mangroves look really cool. I've never seen anything like it.
I know, right? Mangrove trees live where the fresh water from the Everglades meets the salt water from the ocean. We're standing on the edge of one of the biggest mangrove forests in the world.
Really?
Really. So it's the end of the dry season and just the beginning of the wet season, but the mangroves are influenced by another cycle since they're so close to the sea.
Are you talking about the tides?
You got it. Mangroves are an intertidal habitat. That means there's a change in tides every day, a low tide and a high tide. The pulse of tidal water in and out of the mangroves is key to their survival.
Like the yearly cycle between the wet and the dry season in the Everglades. But here, the flooding and draining happen every single day.
Yeah, actually twice each day. The flat Everglades coast is huge, which creates a huge intertidal area and thus a huge mangrove forest. Tides transform a sluggish, salty system into the most productive system in the Everglades. Tides wash toxic compounds, debris, and salt buildup out of the mangroves. Tides also wash in oxygenated water from the sea and fresh water from the slough. When fresh water mixes with salt water, it's called brackish water. All of this washing around makes nutrients more available for the mangrove residents.
That kind of reminds me of the cycles of a washing machine. The rinsing and the draining. The water flowing in and out.
You're one step closer to unlocking the mysterious mangrove forest of the Everglades. Mangrove trees flourish in the subtropical, intertidal, salty environment where no other trees can survive. Here, along the Everglades coastline, are four kinds of mangroves: red, black, white, and one called the buttonwood. Each one is a marvel with unique adaptations for living on the salty coast.
Which one is this?
This is the red mangrove. Red mangroves have long, arching roots called prop roots. Prop roots first reach out and then curve down to the soil.
The roots look like legs that want to get up and walk across the water.
Prop roots also have special pores called lenticels that supply air to the submerged roots. Red mangroves are most common along the outer coastline, where waves and tides are greatest. Prop roots increase tree stability in this wild, unstable environment. Red mangroves are the first line of defense during hurricane storm surges and strong winds. They actually absorb floodwaters and help prevent the coast from washing into the bay through erosion.
What's this?
Oh, that's a mangrove propagule. That's the seedling that starts growing on the parent tree.
Oh.
So it floats around like this for a while until it becomes waterlogged. And then when it gets waterlogged, it tips upright. And then it sprouts the roots and sprouts the leaves. And eventually maybe it takes hold and becomes a new tree.
Oh, very cool.
Let's walk a bit inland. Black mangroves are more common along the inner coastline where tides are much lower. Can you see why it's called a black mangrove? The black mangrove has these cool adaptations to their roots. They're called pneumatophores, and they grow straight up out of the mud to just above the highest water level. They're like little breathing tubes or snorkels that provide air to the flooded roots. The roots of red and black mangroves do a great job of filtering the salt from the seawater. Roots block most of the salt, but some salt does slip through. The black mangrove excretes this excess salt through glands on its leaves. Tasting is believing.
Salty. Tastes like black mangrove.
Hey, let's go for a canoe ride.
Okay, that sounds great.
Most of the mangroves around here are red mangroves, but there's also a buttonwood right there in front of you.
This one?
Yeah. It has smaller yellow-green leaves. Buttonwood is named after the fruit, which kind of looks like buttons. See the rough bark of the buttonwood? It's a great place for those air plants to land and take root. The mangrove forest is a wonderful home for lots of animals. See the dense mangrove foliage, the maze of prop roots above and below the water, and the rich mud? Another thing about mangroves is they do not like fire. They're actually fire intolerant. Mangrove trees cannot resprout after a fire. However, fire does help to keep them out of the neighboring coastal prairie, which is fire dependent.
So, the mangrove is like the hardwood hammock and cypress that don't like fire. On the other hand, the sawgrass prairie and pine rocklands need fire.
You see this? This is the base of the mangrove food web.
This mangrove leaf?
Mm-hmm. Mangrove leaves fall into the water and become food for decomposers like fungus and bacteria. Decomposing leaves become food for grazing invertebrates like juvenile fish, crabs, shrimp, and oysters. These prey then attract carnivores like bigger fish, birds, mammals, people, and reptiles like the endangered American crocodile. Wading birds can roost above in the mangrove canopy and then forage below in the exposed mudflats. The mangrove forest is an important nursery for hordes of juvenile fish and invertebrates. They use the mangroves for only the beginning phase of their life cycle. Then they leave here when they are big enough to survive in the adjacent open waters of Florida Bay or the Gulf of Mexico.
So the next time I eat shrimp and lobster from the ocean, I have to thank the little mangrove leaf who fed the shrimp and lobster who are feeding me.
You got it. So, what'd you think of the mangrove?
The mangrove forest is less mysterious now that I understand some of the adaptations, the food web, and some of its residents. There is still a lot of mystery for me. I really like to see what it looks like underwater.
I know, me too. The dry season's a great time to visit. During the wet season, the salt marsh mosquito kind of takes over. So there's one more habitat left for you to explore downstream from the mangroves. Good luck.
Thank you. Thanks for showing me around.
Sure thing. Have fun.